You have to wonder, at a certain point, does it start to tamp down deal flow? I mean, it might not be a situation where these data breaches pose an existential threat to the companies, but it does sound expensive, especially when you factor in stuff like insurance. Are we starting to see a point in time where these looming threats could impact deal flow on a year-to-year basis?
I wouldn't say that this would impact deal flow. I think we just need to integrate a focus on these issues the same way we integrate a focus on ROI after the deal is closed. And I think there is a failure right now for many companies that are doing deals to think about these issues.
I mean, Lee, you made a good point, which is that on the deal flow point, I don't really think that this focus is going to tamp down deal flow for a number of reasons, which is A, it's relatively manageable, even if you're not in great shape and you have to increase your cyber resilience either before closing or after closing. It usually is not a material sum of money in relation to the size of the deal. And number two, these risks are largely insurable, and so you can get at this point a fair amount of balance sheet protection through cyber insurance. So I think that's a factor that mitigates against the focus on this topic tamping down deal flow.
Well, and one other interesting thing is now that it is so much in the spotlight, the typical board is going to be doing a lot more focus on how do we get our game up to snuff here internally before we even get into the M&A environment. I mean, I think it should make it easier when you go to enter in negotiations with somebody to get an assessment of where they are and how they're doing, because they themselves ought to have been, they shouldn't have been asleep on the switch.
Companies would be well advised to get their house in order before entering into the due diligence process. You know, certainly it's only in the past 2 or 3 years that we've started to do really a very significant number of tabletop exercises. I'm sure, Eric, you've done many of them. But not just cyber tabletop exercises to prepare for the inevitable breach. And breaches, by the way, are of all varieties. There are some very, very small ones, and there are some very, very significant ones, but way fewer of those. But we've done these tabletop exercises not only with C-suites, who are really at the forefront of managing these issues when they occur, but also with boards, so that they understand the arc of a breach, the timeline, and they have some sense of it when it does happen, so that they're asking the right questions when and if it actually does happen.
It sounds like corporate culture could be a big indicator of how these types of things are going to go. Steve, I was wondering if you could talk to us a little bit about transaction documents and what they should look like in today's reality.
Well, the great thing is in the M&A context, there is some room for creativity. The first and most obvious option is that you could reduce the purchase price if you've identified issues. Second, you could look to reps and warranties. I think we're seeing a dramatic shift away from relying on reps for general compliance with law and intellectual property, and actually eliciting specific representations and warranties on cybersecurity issues. The next option could be closing conditions. That would be unusual, but you could actually negotiate for a closing condition tied to, for example, the absence of a cybersecurity incident. And then there's also indemnification, which wouldn't be available in a public company acquisition, but which could be available in private company acquisition. And that would allow you to seek recourse after the closing from the sellers. That would give rise to issues such as how large is an escrow account going to be and whether that would cover your damages and what's the time frame for making a claim. But all those are potential options to address this issue in purchase agreements.
What about post-closing?
Post-closing. Well, the hope is that the house is reasonably well in order pre-closing, but often it's not. So post-closing, we would want to go in there very quickly and set out a hierarchy, a priority list of what needs to get done first. The critical issue there is that the target company needs to be right on board with you because they know what they've been doing. They know what their systems look like. They know what their data looks like. They know how they've used their data, with whom they've shared their data, what their vendor management program looks like. Without their cooperation, it's very difficult, I think, to move forward in a sort of routinized way to tick off all the issues. But very important to do it, to jump on that bandwagon quickly.
Another reason to do it quickly is that if you do have indemnification, there's usually a time period by which you have to make a claim.
And the question is, what is the survival period? And we certainly want to think hard about that. And that's going to depend on the due diligence. What do we find in the diligence? Do we understand the issues such that we can understand what claims might be made and what statute of limitations might apply?
And I think you mentioned a transaction, Eric, you had where actually there were funds escrowed that you could look to.
Exactly.
Which
Sometimes is a nice extra plus. Right. Sometimes the post-closing full security enterprise risk assessment and the remediation is tied to the escrow fund.
You know, the other interesting thing here is we have been talking in the context of acquiring and acquired. If you're talking about a combination of equals, this is a two-way street. I mean, you're assessing both of them. I mean, which ought to create a less challenging framework for.
Do you think most target companies realize that? I didn't even think of that in preparation of this event.
Well, they clearly should. I mean, unless it's an all, you know, I mean, you know, unless you're just getting all cash, I mean, you're picking up exposure on the other side, no question.
Well, Alan, you make a great point, because I've seen situations in which when we come in and do our assessments, our technical assessments, the acquired company is in way better shape than the acquirer. And that drives lots of very interesting cyber governance challenges, because often you have to take the best of both companies and try to combine them into one. And when you do that, you may have to break a couple eggs, because there's personnel changes, but also there has to be an openness by everybody to adopt the best practices no matter where they come from. We've done that with our own company. We've acquired seven companies, and sometimes the companies that we acquired have had, in certain respects, way better practices and procedures than we have, and we have made those the law of the land. And you need to have, at the cyber governance level, you need to have a tone at the top that says, we don't care where the ideas come from, we're just going to adopt the best ideas to improve our security.
A very scary context, I would say, is when you've got the acquiring company is controlled by a group of hedge funds, for example, or somebody like that, who have their company is heavily focused on cost takeouts and things like that. They're willing to put a very attractive price on the table for the target in some kind of combination of shares. And the board of the target is then facing a situation where the greater risk is really the tight cost controls over on the acquiring company.